everybody. Welcome to First Baptist Church, North Kansas City. So very pleased to be in the house of the Lord together with you today to just look upon the body of Christ together today. Well, we are very pleased you're here today. I want to catch you up on a few things in our active community here. One is that we have on next Sunday, October 13th, we have a flu clinic. They come every year. We set it up in the parking lot. It's either drive by or walk up, and they will give you a free flu shot. So we would love to have everyone vaccinated and protected, and so just take an opportunity to get your flu vaccine next Sunday when you are here. Then also next Sunday, the pastor and I and are calling the purpose of selecting Alan Lewis as associate pastor of worship. So this is coming from the personnel committee that have already made that recommendation, and then we're bringing it to the church, as is our practice, past practice, to bring all pastoral positions before the church. So we will be bringing Alan Lewis up for a vote. Yeah, that doesn't count. That doesn't count. We have to affirm you next Sunday. All right, and we are looking forward to that meeting next week. Then also, I have a flyer in my hand, and if you have not heard, I don't know where you have been, but we're having a fall festival on Saturday, October the 19th. And yesterday we had, remember I asked people if they wanted to get their steps in, and they did. We had lots of people come yesterday, got lots of steps in, and we hit many homes in this neighborhood. Just put a door hanger out, but we had lots of wonderful encounters with the community and opportunities to just talk about faith and talk about our church and talk about Jesus. So it was wonderful. Anyway, for the Fall Fest, you don't want to miss it. We still need volunteers. I've got to sign up over here. I'm still looking for people who will set up, clean up, sit at a booth, greet people, pray for people, do safety team. We've got lots of opportunities. There's every skill level. You can be a part of this, and it is obviously Saturday, October the 19th. Well, with those things in mind, we're going to continue our worship together this morning.
Amen. We're going to worship our awesome King. If you're able to, let's stand. We're going to sing a Worship the King. These different verses tell different parts of God's majesty. In that second verse, have you ever seen a storm and thought about how awesome God is? When we get to that second verse, I want you to think about that. When we get to the third verse, think about how he cares for us. Even that awesome God cares for us. Let's sing this together.
Our shield and
standing for a reading from Psalm 50. From Psalm 50, the mighty one, God, the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to where it sets. From Zion, perfect in beauty, God shines forth. Our God comes and will not be silent. A fire devours before him, and around him a tempest rages. He summons the heavens above and the earth that he may judge his people. Gather to me this consecrated people who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. And the heavens proclaim his righteousness, for he is a God of justice. Listen, my people, and I will speak. I will testify against you, Israel. I am your God. I bring no charges against you concerning your sacrifices or concerning your burnt offerings, which are ever before me. I have no need of a bull from your stall or of goats from your pens, for every animal of the forest is mine and the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know every bird in the mountains and the insects in the fields are mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you, for the world is mine and all that is in it. Do I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats? Sacrifice thank offerings to God. Fulfill your vows to the Most High and call on me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you and you will honor me. Those who sacrifice thank offerings honor me, and to the blameless I will show my salvation. Readings from Psalm 50 for the good of God's people. Amen.
You can be seated. Man, when we come into God's house and we sing a hymn like this one that Alan picked for us this morning, and then we hear about God, mighty he is, how perfect, how just and righteous are all his ways. And so the law of the Bible summarizes that, all of God's many perfections. And when Jesus was asked to summarize the law, he did it like this. The greatest commandment is this: you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depends all the law and the prophets. So I want to invite you to just take a moment and reflect silently where you're at. You know, there's not a week that goes by, but God is good and gracious and abounding in mercy. So I want to invite you to reflect on that where you are, and then Pastor Mike's going to come and gather all of our prayers together.
Father, mighty God, our good and gracious and giving God, creator God, provider God, healing God, infinite God, that you know us and that you love us and that through you we have forgiveness. From you we have that you have a plan and a purpose for each of our lives, that you desire a relationship with us, that we would commune with you, that we would be your people and you would be our God, that you would glory in us and we would glorify you, that there would be strength and power and might in your spirit, that there would be a peace and a calm for us in the storms and trials and troubles of life, and that we can come to you with all of our shortcomings, our misgivings, our sin, our failures, our stumblings, our wallowing in the mud, We can come to you, this our God, and call on your name and receive your Son, who is Jesus Christ, whom you sent from heaven to earth for your plan and your purpose to redeem us, to set us right with you, to cover us in his righteousness through his blood. So thank you, Father. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you, Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, our Redeemer. Thank you for your sacrifice to buy us back, to bring us back. Should we call on your name, should we confess our sin, then we are adopted children of the Most High God. Thank you, Jesus. And thank you, Holy Spirit, for stirring us and wooing us and calling us and bringing us and choosing us and drawing us into confession, to repentance, and to righteousness through our Savior Jesus Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for indwelling us to guide our steps, our paths, our way, to set us on the course of life that is pleasing to you and the best for us. Thank you, Holy Spirit, Lord Jesus, and our Father who art in heaven. May we take hope in all of this, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. This is a time where we want you to go ahead and fellowship together. So stand up and look around and find someone to shake hands with or high five or fist bump or however you do that.
So, I think take my wife's hands.
No, how does it go?
Oh. I know.
Righteousness is what I long for. Righteousness is what I need. Righteousness, righteousness is what you want for me.
I sing brokenness.
Brokenness is what I long for.
have some scripture read. Bert's coming to read from the New Testament. Let's remain standing for the scripture reading.
I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Romans 12, 1 and 2.
Would you pray with me, please? God, I praise you and I thank you that we can come to this place, that we can worship you, raise our hands and our voices to you in worship. I pray for our country. I pray for those that are hurting in Florida and in the other states where all the flooding is going on, that's lost a lot of material things, but it's got to be weighing on them heavily, mentally, physically, and stressful. So I pray that you'll just be with them and guide and direct them. God, also just pray for our upcoming festival, that we might be able to reach this community in some way and that we might be able to build a relationship with the people that live here, and that they might ask questions and they might eventually accept you as their Lord and their Savior. I pray for the Dakin family as they're preparing for the celebration of life this weekend, the loss of Charlie. And I pray that you will just use that for the good, and that you will bless them, comfort them, I also want to pray for the Middle East and the other hostility places around the world, that in your own way, you'll bring peace about all of this. So God, I just ask that the Holy Spirit continue to work in this service. I've been able to feel it today in the songs, in the prayers that have been lifted up to you. It's been great. So as Pastor Patrick comes and opens the word and shares what's on his heart, what you've put on his heart, that we might have the ears to hear and that we might put things aside that would be a distraction, that we might be able to concentrate and take away from this service something that we can use to further your kingdom and put joy into our lives. God, I can't help but just right now just think of those that suffer from mental illness and the families that support them. So we love you. We know that you have for us what is your will in our lives. Amen.
Amen. In just a moment, we're going to take our offering while we sing this song, Heart of Worship. I'm just going to start it. You remain seated while the ushers come take the offering. And if a lot of times there's something that we're making more important than God, even in our worship. Maybe it's our favorite song or favorite kind of song, or the fact we're not doing our favorite song. Just whatever it is, if there's some kind of thing that has distracted you, while I start singing this song, just think about what that is. And then join in. Join in and just give everything to God. All is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. Sing this together. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. I'll bring you more than a song. And just repeat that. Here we go. I'll bring you more than a song.
I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song.
Sing that again. I'll bring you more than a song. Search much deeper within through the way things appear.
You search much deeper within through the way things appear.
Sing that again. You search much deeper.
You search much deeper within through the way things appear.
Amen. Now I'll bring you more than a song. chorus, just the voices. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we are to pray. You are always inclined to give more than we desire or deserve. Pour down on us the abundance of your mercy. Forgive us those sins which cause us fear, and give us those good things for which we are not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God in glory everlasting. God, just help us now. Prepare us to hear your word. If we weren't ready before, if we couldn't get ready during the singing, if we couldn't get ready on this last song, that we're ready right now to hear your word and to let it move into our hearts and minds and our thinking and our souls and change us, conform us to be like you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. If you have your Bibles and you haven't already, go ahead and open them up to Romans chapter 12. I kind of toyed with the idea this morning of being a little ornery. Is that a word in your families? Yeah, I thought about saying open your Bible to Acts, but it's not, it's Romans. We're moving on. We're going to start a new series this week from several chapters of this glorious epistle, focusing on unity in the church, and in particular the kind of unity that needs to persist in the midst of diversity. You know, there's an old saying about finding a perfect church. They're hard to find, and if you ever find one, the minute that you join, it won't be perfect anymore. Have you ever heard that one? You know, diversity is like that in the church. The reality is, whether it's seen or unseen, whether it's below the surface, people have different opinions. They have different life stories. They come from different places. Diversity exists in the church, whether we like it or don't. It does exist in the church. So when we speak of it, though, it is necessary, I think, to take a minute and talk about what we're describing. We're describing this kind of beautiful human collage that even now, right now, exists before the throne of Christ. Right now. And will forever and ever. A diversity of race, language, of denomination, and even of opinions within those denominations and between those denominations. Yes, even many of the Methodists who have so skillfully and persistently outwitted us in getting to the lunch line first, they will also be there. We will all be together in one place, and we will all keep one feast. But what we are not describing is a concept in which there are no outer bounds to the confession of the church. We're not describing that kind of diversity. A notion in which truth is ultimately relative and the claim of Jesus on our lives is simply whatever we define it to be. Nor are we describing the kind of unity that results from a fear of conflict. We're not talking about that kind of unity persisting in the midst of diversity. The kind of unity that we're going to be talking about over the next few weeks can only exist within a community that is bounded by the absolute and unqualified lordship of Jesus, centered on the truth that makes him before all and over all and the one for whom all things exist. Any other definition of unity besides this one is a counterfeit. It is actually ego, human ego masquerading. So before we dive into the text, I also want to take a few minutes to explain why this series, why I think this issue of proper unity, of biblical unity in the midst of diversity, is so critical to the future of our church. The work we are called to do together is one of renewal. In ministry practice and context, the term renewal refers to, quote, a strategy of spiritual revitalization, structural change, community engagement, and leadership development that is designed to address declining membership and influence. That's what renewal means. And actually, this is not just our task. It is the task of the whole church in the West, everywhere. A 2021 radio interview transcript that I came across from WBUR, which is the NPR affiliate in Boston, lays this out very incisively. In 1995 and 2020, approximately 40 million people in the United States de-churched. 40 million people. In economic terms, this represents $1.3 trillion of gross domestic product walking out the back door of the church and taking all of its influence and voice with it. Our tendency is to think about this exodus primarily driven by theology, but the science lays out a more complex picture. There actually is some of it that is theologically driven. Much of it is theologically driven, but a greater factor is probably the very nature of modern life in the West. The very nature of modern life. Life is busy and it is getting busier. This makes church commitment an increasingly inconvenient claim. Above and beyond theological controversies that surround the nature of the Bible, of salvation, of human sexuality, and the like, church has become increasingly inconvenient. You may know this, but people will quibble over doctrinal precision. But they will draw a line in the sand and go to war over matters of convenience. All of which makes this work of church renewal and replanting, rebuilding our church and its witness in our community incredibly difficult under the best of circumstances. Under the best of circumstances, it is a difficult work that God calls us to together. I alluded to this a little bit a few weeks ago as a tie-in to our new series, but this very difficulty of unity and of calling people out of the inconvenience of modern life into the church makes unity a critical determining factor for success. Churches that achieve and protect a healthy kind of unity through the costly process of renewal emerge from it missionally, theologically, and socially stronger for the work of the kingdom. It matters. But Satan, that great accuser of the church, specializes in slicing and dicing the body into myopic interest groups. It's one of his favorite plays out of the playbook. Churches who cannot achieve and maintain unity are playing right into his hands. And as a result, they very often fade away, or they die quickly and dramatically as the piper's price for misplaced priorities. In his own way, I think Benjamin Franklin summed this up pretty well. This whole principle on July 4th, 1776, just after signing the Declaration of Independence, he said, "And now we must all hang together, or we shall assuredly all hang separately." Letter to the Romans. And today we're going to focus on where Paul makes that turn from the theological to the practical in chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. It's an inflection point. That's the buzzword today. It's an inflection point in the letter to the Romans. We begin by looking at the first clause of the first sentence. "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God." So at this point, if we hadn't already heard the rest of the passage and we didn't know anything else about Romans, we would know that Paul wants us to do something, and the reason he wants us to do it is because of what he describes as God's mercies. God's mercies. What does he mean by this? Well, basically everything that he's just spent 11 chapters describing, okay? Since this is the motivation for what follows, in some sense, not just for today, but for the next 7 weeks, I think it bears summing up. So here's some of the high points. Every living person knows enough to be accountable to God. Every living person knows enough to be accountable to God. And that means every living human being knows that they have messed up. Most of us at least have a lingering suspicion that those mistakes also mean something about our relationship with the Lord. The truth is, no one really wants to worship the kind of God that holds no one accountable. Not really. At some point, most of us, if we're honest, have probably secretly wanted God to hold someone else accountable for something that has hurt us or hurt someone we love or hurt someone that we think is vulnerable. But the minute that we want God to be holy in his judgment of immediately. That's why the law is a snare. If there is no divine law, then God is simply indifferent to human brutality. He doesn't care. But if on the other hand there is a divine law and there is a divine law, then we know God does care. God does care because every sin hurts someone God loves. Whether it's you or someone else. We know with seeking certainty that we are the offenders. It's like the old comic strip Pogo. We have met the enemy, and he is us. And that means that God is altogether right and just in pronouncing a certain and dreadful judgment on us all. But God. Did you know those are the two most important words in the Bible? For us anyway. But God in his kindness sent his only son to satisfy our obligation under the law. In truth, the crucifixion that he suffered was our crucifixion. For all of our waywardness. But because Jesus' body was broken on the tree, God can remain just in all of his people. What is at stake in the cross of Jesus Christ is the integrity of God. By the blood of Jesus, both Jew and Gentile can be forgiven and made right with God apart from works through faith in the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us. That is why the gospel is an announcement. It is an announcement of good news. He is the narrow way, the gate to freedom and peace, the prodigal's path that leads back from the mud. Is it any wonder then, after all of this, Paul ends Romans 11 with such an emotional outburst. Oh, the depths of the riches and wisdom of the knowledge of God. How unsearchable are all his judgments and inscrutable are all his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? When that truth takes hold of your heart, the whole Christian life follows like a hymn of gratitude. It just rises up as naturally as slow air fiddle rises from a Celtic landscape. The whole Christian life, the pursuit of holiness and humility, unity must spring from a wellspring of gratitude. When our hearts and minds are fixed on the mercies of God, all the other things that are clamoring for our loyalties and our attentions diminish because he must increase. All our pet causes are put into right perspective and given the relative weight that they actually deserve under the shadow of the cross. Christian, our ability to remain unified through choices that stretch us and demand from us and challenge our commitments will be in direct So the right kind of Christian unity is grounded, first of all, in gratitude. Now look with me at the second half of verse 1 and the first half of verse 2. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercy of God, and this is where it begins, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. There is a poetic, really, kind of parallelism to what's happening here, what Paul is doing, and it reinforces what I think is a really, really critical notion for Christian discipleship. When we think about the idea of living sacrifices, of course, immediately it draws to mind a contrast with the dying sacrifices of the Old Testament, right? But we don't need those kind of sacrifices anymore because Christ has become our Passover lamb. There is no longer any need for dying sacrifices because through him we keep the feast. That's an important distinction because when we present our bodies as living sacrifices, it's really critical that we understand it's not contributing to our salvation. That's a work that Jesus is doing. Interesting when we start to think about the contrast that Paul has kind of baked in poetically almost to this. The word that he uses for body is soma. It's given us the English word somatic or psychosomatic, if you've ever heard those terms. Normally, it is the word for the physical body as a whole. The next few chapters will tell in more detail what Paul means by offering our bodies as a living sacrifice, what in particular. But here, what's critical is the notion of consecration, that our bodies are to be set apart, that it matters to God what we do with our bodies. It is this essentially Hebrew idea that God cares deeply about the human body. He gave it to us. But then Paul makes an unexpected kind of turn in the middle. And you know, the best turn in any book is the unexpected turn, right? And he says that this physical act is a logikin latreion, a phrase that the ESV translates spiritual worship. Normally, the word for spiritual is pneumatikos, something having to do with pneuma, spirit, right? If you've heard the word pneumatic, normally that's the word, pneumatikos. Logikin is derived from logos and normally means reasonable, rational, or metaphorical, all of which have to do with the unseen thinking aspect of the person. Did you catch that? That's why they translate it as spiritual. So first, set aside your physical bodies for God's purposes. Let them be consecrated. This is the part of you that the world sees and interacts with. When you do this, it's actually a spiritual form of worship. The outside and the inside are connected. And then in the first part of the next verse, he says, don't be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And here the word he uses for conformed is derived from schematizo, a schematic. Ryan, have you ever seen a schematic? It's a template, right? What does it have to do with? The outer form of something. Don't be conformed to this age means don't conform to the schematic of the world. What determines the outer shape? And the word that he used for transformed also has to do with the outer, what's perceived. It's the same word that in Mark 9:2 and in Matthew 17:2, the gospel's used to describe the transfiguration of Jesus, metamorpho. From this word, we derive the English word metamorphosis, right? Metamorphosis doesn't change one thing into something completely new and different, does it? No. What does it do? Think about a caterpillar. When it goes through metamorphosis, it doesn't become a new and completely different animal. No, the outer presentation or shape of the caterpillar is transformed according to an inner logic or reality, right? What was inside of the caterpillar bursts out for all the world to see. That's what metamorphosis means. That's exactly what transpired with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration, isn't it? Yeah, that's what God wants for the work that he is doing unseen in your heart and mind and spirit. That's what he wants for it to present to the world. The shape of your life should not be like the shape of the world. The inner logic of God's transforming spirit should unfold to make your life beautiful and glorious. So boil it all down, and here's what you get. What happens on the outside constitutes an inner reality. What happens on the inside should constitute an outer reality. Do you see that? What Paul is alluding to here is the profound unity that rests at the center of the Christian life and walk. Unity is not just something that's occasionally nice. It's not an optional upgrade package for the Christian life. It comes standard with every model. As my friend David Stone would say, it's not a bug, it's a feature. Unity is the desire of the soul that longs to be like Jesus. If God has wrought peace and reconciliation in your heart, then this peace should work its way out into a pattern of life that leads to conciliation and unity in the body. And when you use your outer manner of life to pursue conciliation and peace and unity in the body, the way you use your mouth and your hands and your feet, then God accepts this as much more than merely physical. He says it constitutes a spiritual act of worship for him. Okay, so the whole Christian life of obedience flows from gratitude and a desire for the last part of verse 12 to see the fruit of this kind of life, that you may discern what is the will, what is good, the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. This is pretty straightforward, so I'll just leave it at this. Plus, I'm running out of time. When we have the right perspective and motivation, when we are growing into authentic and mature Christians, it helps us to be able to rightly discern the will of God. Let's be clear about this. God's will is for his people to be unified, if at all possible. Holy Scripture is absolutely clear about this. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God." In the Gospel of John, he teaches us a new commandment I give you, that you love one another. Then a little later in the same Gospel, he prays for us all that we should be one. In his letter to the Philippians, Paul pleads with the church, if there's any consolation in Christ, any comfort of love, any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition and conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. The Apostle Peter, in his first letter, urges the church to have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. And finally, the author of Hebrews urges the church to pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. Over and over and over again, we see that unity in the body of Christ is a priority for God. Right now, some of you are thinking, but unity's not always possible, and that's true. Essential truths about God or Jesus or the Bible or human purpose or identity, none of that. But the truth is, the things that we're willing to sacrifice over unity rarely raise to that level. Most of the time, a lack of unity is driven by a lack of Christian maturity and a lack of spiritual formation in which the believer is actively resisting their call to deny themselves, to take up their cross first. God does not want to exalt our pet projects or priorities. He wants to crucify them for the flourishing of his body. All right, so let's bring it home. As individual Christians, we need to be intentional and serious about cultivating gratitude and the perspective that it brings. There's lots of different ways to do that. Spending time in prayer, reading the story of the Bible, talking to other Christians about it, letting it season your speech. Lots of different ways to encourage gratitude. You need to make sure that you continue to worship in a visible, tangible, and sacrificial way. Keep attending, keep volunteering, keep giving generously in all of these tangible forms. Consecrate your outer way of life to the Lord's purposes, because all of them promote unity. Even when there's something going on over the course of the next year that may not jive with you completely, Remember, God calls us to unity. And as a church, first we have to be driven and defined by a culture of gratitude. We do this by showing appreciation and regularly expressing gratitude towards each other and the Lord. So I'll go first. Amy and I are immensely grateful for the kind words and welcome that we have received at this church. We are grateful for you. Each and every one of you has in some way blessed us. We're grateful for it. If you see someone doing something that is worthy of commendation, you need to let one of our staff know. Let Pastor Mike know. Let me know. Let Jackie know. Let Alan know. Let somebody know so that we can recognize people for the good that they're doing. You know, Paul says that those who refresh in spirit are worthy of being recognized for it. Second, for the sake of unity, we have to allow the work that God is doing in our spirit to govern the way that we think and act and speak towards one another when things get stressful and difficult and sacrificial as we pursue renewal together. And they will. They will. You can count on it. Satan does not want this church to make it. Did you know that? We need, for the sake of unity, to allow the work that God is doing in our spirit, underground, under the surface, to burst out and control the way that we think and act and love towards one another. And finally, we need to understand that the right kind of unity is God's will for our church, and pursuing that kind of unity is not optional. It is a matter of obedience. So I want to just close with a couple questions. What is God asking you to lay down for the sake of unity? It's not a matter of if, it's a matter of what. How is God asking you to reach out and show gratitude to your brothers and sisters, to your church, to Him? How is He asking you to cultivate that in your own life? And finally, what are you discerning as the will of God? Does the will of God look something suspiciously like your own reflection? A lot of times it does, especially for pastors, by the way. How are you discerning God's will? I would encourage you to seek it where it may be found, in God's word and in the fellowship of the church. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the way that it gives us hope and lifts us up, for the way that it shapes us and forms us, for the beautiful symmetries that we find in it, God, for the way that your Holy Spirit has inspired it for the good of the church. God, thank you. We are grateful. We don't say it enough. Help us to live lives of gratitude so that we can pursue unity, God. Help our unity to be genuine and authentic and grounded in Christ's love for us. And we pray all of this in his holy name. Amen. So Alan's going to lead us together here in a song. I heard on a clip that Amy showed me, I think it was, what was it? It was some one of the social medias. But it was fantastic. If God is asking you to do something today, do not delay. Do not delay. As we're singing here today, if God lays something on your heart, you do business with him today, okay? Let's stand and we're going to sing together.
Take my
Amen. Well, many of you probably noticed that we had a couple come forward. If they would stand for just for a moment here, James and Jessica Brinkman. They have two children who are also believers, and they're coming up. That we have sent for them, and they're going to stand up here at the end of our service, and we're going to have at least Alan Kirkendall and maybe others from their small group who would stand with them at the end of our service. What they are doing is making a decision to plant their lives here at First Baptist Church.
Amen.
But before that, they made a decision to plant their lives with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And they have followed Jesus Christ into the baptismal waters and buried their old life and raised a new life with him. And so they are coming from a sister church, and then we will receive a letter from that sister church that states that they have made that profession of faith. So Alan and the Binkmans, we got the boys up here, they're coming forward, all four, to join our church today. All right, so with that, I do want to remind our church family that we do have a celebration of life on Friday. 10 o'clock is the visitation, 11 o'clock is the service for Charles Dakin. And then I also want to just send us off with this thought in mind, that together, individually and together, that we call out to our God, that he would unify us, yeah? That we would have unity in him, that he would take our hearts and mold them, our heart and mold it. That he would take our mind together, transform it. And that he would take our will, my will, and our will, and he would conform it to his, in unity with him. And with his church, with God as our Savior, as he goes before us, we are dismissed today. Please come and greet and welcome this church to this beautiful family, the Binkmans.